This picture shows the position and the parts of the pancreas. The pancreas consists of parts: the head, neck, body, and the tail, from right to left. The head of the pancreas is marked by number 5, and it lies in the concavity of the duodenum, just to the right of the midline of the body. Just to the right of the midline of the body. And this head, number 5, gives a process called uncinate process, marked number 6, which is directed to the left side, having a gap between it and the rest of the pancreas. And in this gap passes the superior mesenteric artery and vein. So number 6 is the uncinate process. Uncinate means hook-like. Hook-like, like a hook. So number 5 is the head. Number 1 is the neck of the pancreas. It is called the neck, although it is not narrow or well-defined or something like that. But the neck of the pancreas is defined by the beginning of the portal vein. The beginning of the portal vein, deeper to the pancreas, corresponds to the neck. Corresponds to the neck. So the neck of the pancreas is the area which lies opposite the beginning of the portal vein from the union of the splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein. So number 1 is the area of the neck. Number 7 is the body of the pancreas, passing horizontally on the posterior abdominal wall towards the left, and it ends at the left side of the abdominal cavity in a narrow free end called the tail of the pancreas. Number 8. The left free end, narrow end of the body is called the tail, and this tail comes in contact with the visceral surface of the spleen. The spleen is number 9. So this is the position and the parts of the pancreas. The parts of the pancreas lies horizontally across the posterior abdominal wall, and it crosses over the vertebral column, and it lies in front the first, in front of the first and the second lumbar vertebrae, in front of the first and second lumbar vertebrae. And if the pancreas is inflamed, pancreatitis, the pain may be referred to the vertebral column in the region of the first and the second lumbar vertebrae, because it lies directly in contact with these vertebrae. At the upper border of the pancreas, we see number 2 is a cut section of the celiac trunk. The celiac trunk, which is a branch from the abdominal aorta. This celiac trunk lies immediately above the upper border of the pancreas. And here, at this point, there is an elevation projecting from the upper border of the pancreas, marked by number 3. It is called the omental bursa. It's called omental because it comes in contact with the lesser omenta. It's called omental bursa. No, sorry, omental tuberosity. Omental tuberosity. Because it comes in contact with the omental bursa or the lesser sac, because the lesser sac is called the omental bursa. And this tuberosity or elevation comes in contact with this sac, with this bursa, with this omental bursa. So it is called the omental tuberosity. It is related to the celiac trunk. These are the features of the position and shape of the pancreas. This diagram shows a cross section in the body of the pancreas, showing its borders and the surfaces. The body of the pancreas appears in section to be triangular, having three borders and three surfaces. Number one is the upper border directed upward. Number seven is the inferior border directed downward. Number four is the anterior border directed forward. And between these borders, there are three surfaces. Number three is the anterior surface. Number five is the inferior surface directed downward. And number six is the posterior surface, which lies in contact with the vertebral column directly without peritoneal covering, without peritoneum here. The pancreas is retroperitoneal. It is only covered on its superficial surface, but not on its deep surface. It is like the kidney. It is retroperitoneal. The peritoneum in the diagram is number two. It covers the anterior surface and the inferior surface, but not the posterior surface. This picture shows the vascular relations at the upper border of the pancreas. The pancreas in general is related to many vessels, and starting by the upper border we see number three is the celiac trunk. The celiac trunk close to the upper border of the pancreas, where the omental tuberosity number four lies. So it is related to the upper border of the pancreas, celiac trunk itself. And the celiac trunk gives the hepatic artery to the right side, number five, the hepatic artery. So the hepatic artery lies close to the upper border on the right side. But the main artery which lies on the upper border is the splenic artery, number two. The splenic artery has a wavy or tortuous course along the upper border of the pancreas, and it ends in the left side of the abdominal cavity, where the spleen lies, the spleen number eight. And here the splenic artery gives branches to the spleen that enter through the hilum of the spleen. And as the splenic artery passes to the left along the upper border of the pancreas in the region of the tail, it lies in front of the left kidney. In front of the left kidney. The left kidney is number one. The tail of the pancreas is marked number seven. The body of the pancreas is marked number six. So these are the arteries related to the upper border. But we have to note that the splenic vein is lower than the splenic artery, and therefore it comes behind the body of the pancreas. So the splenic artery is at the upper border, but the splenic vein is behind the body. Why? Because the vein lies at a lower level. So it comes behind the body of the pancreas. The celiac trunk, which is number three, comes in contact with the omental tuberosity, number four. It is a slight elevated area, a slight elevation or projection at the upper border of the pancreas, at the upper border of the pancreas, in the midline of the body. So these are the arteries related to the upper border of the pancreas. This surface shows the important anterior relations, anterior relations of the pancreas. The structures in front of the pancreas are number 5, number 5, the body of the stomach, the body of the stomach is an important relation. It lies in front of the body of the pancreas, from which it is separated by the lesser sac or emunctal bursa. And here, behind the body of the stomach, the borders of the pancreas are shown by dotted line to show that the pancreas lies behind the stomach. So the stomach is an anterior relation. Number two is the right part of the transverse colon. Number two, as the transverse colon begins in front of the second part of the duodenum, this is the beginning of the transverse colon, then it passes to the left, it comes in front of the head of the pancreas. So the beginning or the right part of the transverse colon lies in front of the head of the head of the pancreas. Also, the gastroduodenal artery, which is marked by number 1. This gastroduodenal artery is a branch from the common hepatic artery in the free border of the lesser omentum, and it descends behind the first part of the duodenum. And here, it lies in front of the head of the pancreas and is marked by dotted line. Number 1, because it lies behind the first part of the duodenum, and at the lower border of the duodenum, of the first part, it divides into two divisions. One to the right, the gastroepiploic, right gastroepiploic, and one to the left, which is right gastroepiploic, and one directed to the right, which is a superior pancreatic duodenum. It's two terminal divisions of the gastroduodenal. The superior pancreatic duodenal, which runs between the duodenum and the head of the pancreas, and the right gastroepiploic, which runs to the left along the greater curvature of the stomach. So the gastroduodenal artery itself lies behind the first part of the duodenum, in front of the head of the pancreas. Anterior relation. Anterior relation. Number 4 marks, this arrow, number 4, marks the presence of the lesser sac, the presence of the lesser sac between the stomach and the pancreas, because the pancreas lies in the stomach bed, in the stomach bed, separated from the stomach by the lesser sac, and the arrow lies in the lesser sac, number 4, the arrow number 4. Number 3 are the superior mesenteric artery and vein. They lie in front of the uncinate process. They come from behind the head and lie in front of the uncinate process, then continue over the horizontal or third part of the duodenum. They are marked number 3. The beginning of the transverse colon is marked by number 2. So these are the important anterior relations, important anterior relations of the pancreas. This picture shows the posterior relations of the pancreas, and these relations behind the pancreas are very many, and they are mainly vessels, arteries, and veins. Let us begin with the structures behind the head of the pancreas, which is surrounded by the duodenum. Number two is the inferior vena cava. The inferior vena cava is the most right structure on the right side behind the head of the pancreas. And here the inferior vena cava receives the right and left renal veins. And therefore, if there is malignancy in the head of the pancreas, the tumor will press on the inferior vena cava and the two renal veins. And we know if the inferior vena cava is obstructed or narrowed, there will be edema in both lower limbs because of the backflow of the venous blood. So number two is the inferior vena cava, the first structure on the right side behind the head of the pancreas. These relations are very important because of the common presence of cancer head of the pancreas. Number one is a superior mesenteric vein, and the superior mesenteric vein joins the splenic vein, which is number 8, to form the portal vein. And the point of junction or union marks the neck of the pancreas. But there is an important structure here behind the head of the pancreas, but it is not shown in the figure. It is a common bile duct, the common bile duct, which descends in a groove on the back of the head of the pancreas, or even within the tissue of the head itself. And this is a relation of utmost importance, because in cancer head of the pancreas, the malignancy will obstruct the bile duct, and in this case bile cannot pass into the duodenum and will accumulate into the bile duct with backflow to the liver, and finally the bile will enter the blood circulation. And this is a case called jaundice. Jaundice means yellowing of the tissues of the body because of the presence of bile in the blood circulation because of obstruction of the bile duct. The common causes of obstruction of the common bile duct is either a stone descending from the gallbladder, gallstone, or malignant tumor, or in the head of the pancreas. So these are the posterior relations of the head of the pancreas, and should be kept in mind. So the structures behind the body, the structures behind the body of the pancreas are number 3 is the abdominal aorta. The abdominal aorta, number 3. And here the abdominal aorta gives off the superior mesenteric artery, the superior mesenteric artery, which is number 4. The superior mesenteric artery, which arises from the abdominal aorta opposite the first number, opposite the first number vertebra. And here the origin of the superior mesenteric artery is related above to the splenic vein and below it related to the left renal vein marked by number 5 left renal vein draining the left kidney. So here the origin of the superior mesenteric artery is related to a vein above it, the splenic vein, and a vein below it, the left renal vein, and these two veins cross the abdominal aorta as it is seen in the diagram, one above and one below the origin of the superior mesenteric artery. Note also that on the right side of the superior mesenteric artery is the superior mesenteric vein number 1, and as I just mentioned, it joins the splenic vein to form the origin of the portal vein, and this origin of the portal vein marks the site of the neck of the pancreas. Then further to the left we find the splenic vein number 8 and the left renal vein number 5 passing horizontally from left to right, the splenic vein above and it drains the spleen, and the left renal vein below and draining the left kidney. The splenic vein is marked number 8 and the left renal vein is marked number 5. So as you see, many relations, important relations, mostly vascular arteries and veins lie behind the pancreas. Other numbers in the diagram are number 6 is the left renal, the left kidney. The left kidney, renal means kidney, left kidney. Number 7 is the left suprarenal gland. Number 9 is the left crus, and number 10 is the right crus of the diaphragm from which the diaphragm takes origin. These are the posterior relations of the pancreas. When we look at the posterior surface or posterior aspect of the spleen, we see the following structures as seen in the diagram. The diagram shows the structures fixed or adherent to the posterior surface of the pancreas, and also to show the course of the bile duct, the common bile duct number 2. The bile duct or common bile duct is seen on the back of the head of the pancreas as it descends downward and to the right to open into the middle of the second part of the duodenum. And we see also the superior mesenteric vein, which is number 3, as it ascends through the gap between the uncinate process of the pancreas and the rest of the head of the pancreas to join the splenic vein number 1, which runs horizontally from left to right, and these two veins form the portal vein. Also number 4 is the inferior mesenteric vein. It comes deep to the body of the pancreas, it ascends deep to the body of the pancreas to join the splenic vein a short distance from its end. So these are the structures seen on the back of the pancreas. This picture shows the ducts of the pancreas. The pancreas is drained by two ducts, a main duct, which is number one, and a smaller duct called the accessory duct, which is marked by number seven. Why the pancreas has two ducts? Because embryologically, during development of the fetus, the pancreas arises from two buds, from two sources, two masses, and these two buds, pancreatic buds in the embryo, will join each other. Each bud has its own duct, and we shall describe this later with the embryology of the pancreas. Here in the diagram we see number one is the main pancreatic duct, the principal one. It extends throughout the whole length of the pancreas, arising from the region of the tail on the left side and passing through the body and passing through the head of the pancreas till it reaches the concavity of the duodenum, of the second part of the duodenum, where it joins the termination of the bile duct. And here they open together in most cases into a dilatation called hepatopancreatic ampulla. Ampulla means a dilated wide part. Hepatopancreatic ampulla, and sometimes called ampulla of Vater. Vater is the name of a scientist. This hepatopancreatic ampulla, which receives the secretions from both ducts, the bile from the bile duct and the pancreatic juice from the main pancreatic duct, the hepatopancreatic ampulla opens into the middle of the second part of the duodenum on the summit of an elevation in the mucous membrane called major or greater duodenal papilla. Papilla means a projection, small projection, marked by number five. Number five is a major or greater duodenal papilla. This is a course of the main pancreatic duct. But the accessory pancreatic duct is smaller and is confined or limited only to the head of the pancreas. And its course is different. It ascends in the head and crosses in front of the main pancreatic duct. And here sometimes they join each other, sometimes. And then it opens into the second part of the duodenum also, but above its middle by about 1 inch. On the surface of a smaller papilla called the lesser or minor duodenal papilla. These papillae, especially the major duodenal papilla, can be seen by the use of the gastroscope. A gastroscope passed through the esophagus and the stomach and the duodenum to see and to examine the opening on the major duodenal papilla, and if there is a stone, for example, you can surgically remove this stone. So it is a landmark, this major duodenal papilla and the lesser duodenal papilla are landmarks for the physician in clinical examination. Number four is the opening of the accessory pancreatic duct on the minor or lesser duodenal papilla, and number seven is the accessory pancreatic duct itself. Number three is the bile duct or common bile duct, and note number two, which is the gastroduodenal artery, which descends along the left side of the left part, ascends on the left side of the lower part of the bile duct behind the superior part of the duodenum. This picture shows the terminations of both the bile duct number 5 and the main pancreatic duct number 4 as they open into the middle of the second part of the duodenum. Both ducts, as they lie in the wall of the duodenum, the wall is marked by number 1, they join each other to form a common sac or dilatation marked by number 3 called hepato pancreatic ampulla. Hepato means liver, pancreatic means pancreas, because here the bile and the pancreatic juice collect here, and this hepato pancreatic ampulla is also called ampulla of Vater. Vater is the name of a scientist. The wall of this hepato pancreatic ampulla is surrounded by fibers of smooth muscle fibers forming a sphincter. This sphincter is called the sphincter of Oddi, and Oddi is the name of a scientist. It is marked by number 2. This is a common presentation, but sometimes they open together. The two ducts open together separately. They open separately on the surface of the major duodenal papilla, the major duodenal papilla or greater duodenal papilla. A papilla is a small projection in the mucous membrane of the duodenum. These are the some details about the termination of the bile duct and the main pancreatic duct into the middle of the second part of the duodenum. Now, let us move to the description of the spleen. The spleen is a large lymphoid organ, contains lymphatic tissue, and it is very vascular. It is very vascular, like the liver, but the liver is not a lymphoid tissue. The spleen is a lymphoid tissue. It belongs to the lymphatic system. It contains large numbers of lymphocytes, monocytes, and blood cells, and is friable, easily lacerated in trauma, and therefore it in traumas and accidents in the left hypochondrium where the spleen lies, it may rupture and leads to severe hemorrhage in the abdominal cavity, which may be fatal. And the problem here is that the hemorrhage is inside the abdominal cavity and is not seen to the naked eye. Note that the splenic artery and splenic vein are large vessels because of the rich amount of blood inside the spleen. So as regards the anatomy of the spleen lies in the left hypochondria under cover of the left ribs, mainly number 9, number 10, and number 11 left ribs, and lie obliquely with its long axis parallel to the axis of the ribs. The 10th rib corresponds to the middle of the spleen, the 10th rib. So it lies deep to the 3 left ribs, 9, 10, and 11th. and the spleen has two ends. Has two ends. An anterior end directed forward and is also called the lateral end, as it is also directed laterally, and a posterior end which is directed toward the vertebral column. It lies close to the vertebral column on the left side, but its lateral end or anterior end reaches as far as the mid axillary line. The mid axillary line is the line that extends vertically in the middle of the axilla. In the middle of the axilla, the lateral or anterior end of the spleen reaches this line and rarely, and does not normally, extends after that. And therefore, the spleen is completely hidden by the left ribs. And it is difficult to feel the rib, to feel the spleen by clinical examination, by palpation of the anterior abdominal wall, except if it is enlarged. If it is enlarged. If the spleen enlarges, it will protrude from under cover of the left costal margin, and the physician can feel the spleen as a mass below the left costal margin by palpation. A spleen which is felt means that it is an abnormal spleen, an enlarged spleen, but normally it cannot be felt. It is completely hidden under the ribs of the left hypochondrium. Number 2 in the diagram shows the ribs number 9, number 10, and number 11. Number 3 marks the spleen itself. Number 1 is the mid axillary line, where it marks the anterior limit, the anterior limit of the spleen on the surface. Number 4 shows the left colic flexure, which is related to the spleen. The left colic flexure is related to the spleen because the spleen has two surfaces, a surface related to the diaphragm laterally and a surface related to the viscera of the abdominal cavity called the visceral surface or medial surface. This is a position and shape of the spleen. This picture shows the borders, ends, and the visceral surface of the spleen. Shows the shape of the spleen. The spleen has two ends, two borders, and two surfaces. Number 1 is a posterior end, close to the vertebral column, far posteriorly, near the vertebral column, and it is rounded and relatively narrower than the anterior end. The anterior end, marked by number 5, it is larger, longer, and looks like a border. Looks like a border, but it is an end. An end, described as an end. And it is called anterior end or lateral end. The posterior end is also called the medial end because it is directed toward the midline. The anterior end, as I have mentioned in the previous slide, reaches only as far as the mid axillary line on the surface. So number 5 is the anterior end of the spleen. As regards the borders of the spleen, the upper border marked by number 7 shows notches near the anterior end marked by number 6, and these notches are used to identify the upper border from the lower border. Practically, if you see the notches, you say this is the upper border of the spleen and is directed upward, while the lower border marked by number 3 shows no notches and it is smooth, rounded and thicker and shows a ridge marked by number 2 close to it. So it is easy to differentiate between the upper border and the lower border of the spleen. As regards to the surfaces, the lateral surface towards the diaphragm, which is called diaphragmatic surface, is smooth and convex, while the medial surface towards the viscera and is called the visceral surface is marked by the hilum, a transverse fissure marked by number 4, and this hilum transmit the splenic vessels. So the hilum marks the visceral or medial surface. These are the main features of the shape of the spleen. This is the visceral surface of the spleen, showing its relations. The viscera related to the spleen has their impressions. The visceral surface shows 4 impressions. Number 1 is the impression for the stomach. The posterior surface of the stomach is related to this surface and is called gastric impression, means the area related to the stomach, and it lies above the hilum. It is a concave surface, large area. And we remember that the spleen lies in the stomach bed. In the stomach bed, the posterior relations of the stomach, only separated from the stomach by the lesser sac. The lesser sac, which is also called omental bursa. So here, where the stomach lies over the spleen, this is the gastric impression or gastric area above the hilum. But below the hilum, there is a renal area, renal impression, the surface where the spleen comes in contact with the left kidney. The spleen lies over the margin of the left kidney, and here it is connected with the left kidney by a ligament called lieno-renal ligament. Lieno means spleen. So here is the renal impression, the impression or area for the left kidney, number 3. And this area is separated from the hilum by a ridge, a longitudinal ridge, just below the hilum, the posterior part of the hilum. Number 4 is close to the anterior end, which is long. the anterior end of the spleen or lateral end of the spleen, which looks like a border, looks like, and is related to the left colic flexure. Number four is the area for the left colic flexure. And we know the left colic flexure is the termination of the transverse colon on the left side, where it bends on itself to form the flexure and becomes continuous lower down as the descending colon. So here is the area for the left colic flexure. And we have to know that from the wall of the left colic flexure, just below the lateral end of the spleen, there is a ligament extending from the wall of the colon to the diaphragm called phrenico-colic ligament, just below the lateral or anterior end of the spleen. This ligament called phrenico-colic, phrenico-diaphragm, colic means the flexure or the beginning of the ascending colon, just below the anterior or lateral end of the spleen. This phrenico-colic ligament lies below the anterior end of the spleen and supports it. The end rests on this ligament. And if the spleen enlarges, this ligament prevents the spleen from enlarging downward, but allows it only to enlarge forward, forward and slightly downward, but not directly downward. It is protected and prevented from enlarging downward by this phrenico-colic ligament, which supports the lateral end of the spleen. So here, number four is the site of the left colic flexure. The last impression is number five, which is the area related to the tail of the pancreas. A small rounded area, because the tail is rounded and narrow. It comes in contact with this area, just below the anterior end of the hilum. Just below the anterior end of the hilum. So these are the impressions or relations of the visceral surface of the spleen and shortly the gastric area, number one, is above the hilum. The renal area, number three, below the hilum. Number four, the colic area in front of the hilum, anterior to the hilum. And number five, the small area of the tail of the pancreas, just below the anterior end of the hilum. This is another picture showing the viscera related to the spleen. Number three is the gastric impression above the hilum. Number two is the upper border of the spleen. Number one is the left kidney lying below the hilum of the spleen. Below the hilum of the spleen. Number five is the tail of the pancreas that reaches as far as the anterior end of the hilum, just below it. And at the upper border of the tail lies the splenic artery, number six. And the splenic artery ends by giving splenic branches to the spleen that passes through the hilum. Number four is the left colic flexure in relation to the anterior part of the visceral surface in front of the hilum. This picture shows the relations of the lateral surface or the diaphragmatic surface of the spleen. The lateral surface of the spleen, which is smooth and convex, is surrounded or covered by the visceral peritoneum, number 9. The spleen itself is number 1. And this visceral peritoneum, which envelops the whole spleen, as it comes on the medial surface or the visceral surface at the hilum, it forms two ligaments or folds of peritoneum. Number 2 is a gastrosplenic ligament. It is a fold of peritoneum attaching the spleen to the stomach. And number 3, it is another fold called the lieno-renal ligament, connecting the spleen to the left kidney. Lieno means spleen. But the lateral surface is related to the diaphragm. The diaphragm is number 4, but it is separated from it by a space, part of the greater sac of peritoneum, number 8. The spleen is surrounded all through by the greater sac of peritoneum, and it is movable. It is easily movable, only attached by the gastrosplenic and the lieno-renal ligaments at the hilum. So the space around it is the greater sac of peritoneum. The diaphragm, which is number 4, separates the spleen from the chest cavity. And in the chest cavity, we can see number 6 is the base of the left lung. The base of the left lung and its lower border lies opposite the eighth rib in the mid axillary line. And we can see also the lower end of the pleural cavity, number 5, which is called the costo-diaphragmatic recess, the left costo-diaphragmatic recess. And its lower end lies opposite the 10th rib in the mid axillary line. And to the outermost part of these relations lie the chest wall, marked by number 7. This picture shows the two ligaments attached to the spleen. The spleen is attached by two ligaments, which are peritoneal folds, connecting the spleen from the region of the hilum to the stomach and to the left kidney. The ligament attaching the spleen to the stomach, which is number 6, is called the gastrosplenic ligament and is attached to the greater curvature, of the stomach. And in this ligament pass the short gastric arteries from the splenic artery to supply the fundus of the stomach. The stomach in the diagram is marked by number 5. The ligament is marked by number 6, and thus this ligament is a vascular ligament. The second ligament, which is number 2, is also a peritoneal fold extending from the region of the hilum of the spleen to the front of the left kidney, and is called lieno-renal ligament. Lieno means spleen. And this lieno-renal ligament encloses, lodges two important structures: the splenic artery with its vein, splenic vein, in addition to the tail of the pancreas. The tail of the pancreas, which passes through this ligament to reach the visceral surface of the spleen. And therefore, cutting this ligament is very serious and should be made with caution, be cautious to in cutting it, because there are important contents in the lieno-renal ligament: the tail of the pancreas and the splenic vessels. So number two is the rhino-renal ligament. Number four is the left kidney. Number three is the splenic artery. But as the relation of the spleen to the two sacs of peritoneum, the greater sac and the lesser sac, the spleen is almost completely surrounded by the greater sac. The greater sac is marked by number 8. But the lesser sac, which is marked here in the figure by number 1, it reaches only the region of the hilum of the spleen, reaches only on the left side to the region of the folds or ligaments, the gastrosplenic ligament and the rhino-renal ligament, but it does not surround the spleen. So number one is the lesser sac of peritoneum or omental bursa. These are the features of the two ligaments suspending the spleen.